And we are back on Open Line. Chuck Long here with Clint Kelly, attorney Clint Kelly from the Kelly Firm. We're talking about medical malpractice and how it affects you, whether it's a loved one, family member. We've got a lot of you on the line with us right now. We're going to get to as many calls as we can. And as always, if you have a question, you're just wondering, something you've been sitting there for several weeks, several months, wondering about, this is a great time to give us a call and you can ask it on air. So we're going to go right to those phones right now. Robert is on the line with us right now. Robert, thanks for your patience. And do you have a question or a comment for Clint?
I went to my Harry before Thanksgiving, so it's within the time period. They said I was sick or had some disease or something. So I asked if I could leave. They didn't want me to, but they let me. And I couldn't find a parking place. Went back to like 3 in the morning. Couldn't find a parking place. I got a big bus. But anyway, I was sick, you know, like radiation poisoning or something. Anyway, it took till this year I got my PCP switch from Vanderbilt, which wanted to send me out to Franklin. Now I'm on a disability. I couldn't afford to go all that way. And I got switched to co-op, and they've got me with some nice doctors and stuff at St. Thomas downtown. And I had in my esophagus. And I was just wondering, and the only thing I got from my hair was bill, not a letter or anything. Didn't get anything from that. The insurance companies were very nice to... and the doctors in there are very nice. So I was just wondering if I could just get a letter to Mary or the city about intent to see if even if about, because I want to get care, and I really don't have the money, you know.
Okay.
Well, what Robert's talking about, Chuck, is not really what I consider to be malpractice. That is a question of coverage in terms of who is going to provide care for him, who's going to be the one that's responsible for doing it. I do see from time to time clients who call me in a related matter. They're saying, you know, usually it's a loved one. He's being passed around from provider to provider. Sometimes they'll have a job loss. They'll have COBRA coverage, and they'll go into Obamacare, or they'll be on a plan where the plan will change from time to time, and that person can only get care at certain places within a network. So what he's talking about sounds like is he went to Meharry and he got bounced around, and now he's with some people at St. Thomas, and he's wondering whether he has to pay some bills at Meharry. And I'm not real sure about that, but that's beyond the scope of my expertise, because it doesn't sound like that's a malpractice case. It sounds like that's an insurance coverage or a government coverage kind of issue.
Right, so that's more indigence more so than really malpractice.
Correct.
But thank you for calling in, Robert.
Yeah.
We're going right back to the phones. Chris is on the line with us. Chris, do you have a question or a comment for Clint? Are you with us, Chris?
Yes, I'm with you.
Okay, do you have a question or a comment?
Yes, I have a question.
Okay.
My sister died back in 2011 at this Imperial Gardens here in Madison, and I didn't find out until later after they closed them down for a lot of things that they did wrong about some stuff, and I was wondering if the statute of limitations can be waived in those cases, because I had a lawyer once tell me that some judges, like Judge Nixon, might consider like I was an emotional wreck for a year or two after her death, and with my own physical problems, and also the knowledge that you didn't have within that first year. I wonder if those type of extenuating circumstances would waive the waiver, so to speak, at least for a few years.
It is possible. I don't know enough about the potential claim. As I told you, there's an exception that's based on foreign objects and fraud. If you're incompetent, there's an exception based on incompetence. Now, there is what they call a 3-year statute of repose, which means if you don't bring your claim within 3 years, generally the claim is cut off no matter what. But if the person who has the claim is incompetent, meaning that they are mentally judged to not know what their rights are, or if there's something involved in this, maybe there's some fraud involved on the part of the of this, as I said, Imperial Gardens, mm-hmm. something, if there was some fraud and trying to hide the negligence or hide the misconduct, then there may be a claim there. It's just one of those situations where you'd have to kind of look at it and see. But it's a tough hill to climb, Chuck, no matter what, when it's been that long, even if it's fair. I mean, whether it's Judge Nixon or any other judge, they're bound to follow the law. And when it comes to a statute of limitations, it's pretty tough to get over that 1 year climb.
That 1 year. Mm-hmm. So, all right. So, Chris, thank you for calling in this evening. One thing I think a lot of people wonder too is with kind of the situation in the medical profession now, where sometimes doctors are trying to see so many patients, and it's a numbers thing. Are you seeing more cases because of that?
Absolutely. I mean, that is what I believe is the main driver right now of, and particularly in Nashville. In Middle Tennessee, the main driver behind a lot of negligence is the fact that there are so many patients, so much volume, and the supply of the healthcare providers is not sufficient to handle that volume. And you know, these the doctors and the nurses, those people, they have lives too. You know, there's only so many hours they can put into a day. If you think about it, the main responsibility rests with the hospitals. The hospitals are charged with the responsibility to make sure they have adequate staff to handle the workload. And if they don't have enough staff, they've got one or two options: hire more staff or shut down. You know, I mean,
right.
Cut down the number of patients they take, because there is a safety margin you have to maintain. And I'm talking about people who get injured in hospitals. Now, you know, some people go to doctor's offices and have injuries there, but most of my cases now are occurring inside hospitals. And it's simply because, in my judgment, there aren't enough staff. And the staff that is there aren't spending enough time one-on-one with the patient, or they're not spending enough time communicating with other members on the team. Failure to communicate, Chuck, is probably the number one reason why there are medical malpractice cases. If you took all comers, if you had like a pie, I'd say half of that pie, a half slice, is because nurses and other nurses and doctors don't communicate.
Okay, makes sense. If you are just tuning in, we are talking about medical malpractice, how it affects you. Maybe something has happened to you. You've wondered what you could do. What are your rights? Well, this is the show to be watching tonight, because we're talking with expert in the field, attorney Clint Kelly from the Kelly Firm. We're going to go back to our lines right now. Mary's on the line with us. Mary, thanks for waiting. And do you have a question or a comment for Clint?
Yes, I do. Does this apply to a dentist as well, or is this just strictly doctors?
It does apply to a dentist.
Okay.
All right.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Okay. Thanks so much, Mary.
Are we ready?
Yes. Do you have a question, or was that just, yeah?
Mm-hmm. All right. I'm ready.
Okay.
I have a question regarding a dentist that I went to four visits with him to get a new partial. He did the implants twice. It's substandard work both times. The tooth on the front was shorter. Real short than my other tooth, and I refused that. And he then gave me the implants again, and the next time, one of my front teeth that he put on that partial was sticking out like a buck tooth, if you understand what I'm talking about. A buck tooth is sticking out,
right?
Which I don't have that. It's not what I paid for, okay? The insurance paid their portion. My portion was a certain amount. He couldn't fix it. It became very rude because I wasn't going to take those teeth, okay? That's not my teeth. That's not what I'm paying for. In turn, he refunded my portion of my part I had to pay. And on the back of his check, he wrote, if endorsed, or endorsed, relieved, and I won't say his name, him of all responsibility and no fault. Okay? So, therefore, can I cash that check? If he writes that on the back of the check where he refunded me my money, can I cash that check without saying he didn't do anything wrong?
Yes, because the dispute is over the funds, is what she's talking about. The question has to do with the payment. You cannot, that would not be an enforceable release because there's no consideration for it. In that situation, you can't give up your rights over a check like that. I mean, her dispute has to do with the fact that the job wasn't done properly.
Right.
and therefore he's basically refunding her the amount that he charged her personally out of her own pocket for this. It's really a breach of contract action. But she may have a negligence case. The question I have is, she said it's not fixable by him. Is it fixable by another dentist? Can someone else do the same job, create a partial for her that will work? But I would cash that check, no question about it.
Okay. All right, Mary, thank you for calling in this evening. We're going to go back to our lines. I know a lot of
Chuck, yeah. What I'd do is I'd write on the back of that check, I'd scratch out release, and I'd sign my, I'd go ahead and cash it anyway, because the bank's going to cash it regardless of what it says on the back.
Okay.
So, Mary, you just scratch that out on the back and then go ahead and cash it.
Okay, great advice. So, again, Mary, thank you so much for calling in. We do have you on the line with us this evening. We're going to get to as many calls as we can, but we are going to take a break. When we come back, more calls here on Open Line.